So you've heard of 3G, 4G, and 5G. Well, each one is a different generation of wireless network. And the cool part about it is that each one has been so much more powerful than the one before it that it's facilitated a completely new stage in society. So the first ever mobile phones were actually 0G, and even calling them mobile is a bit of a stretch. These were chunky boy phones with a massive box as a receiver. 1G was the first time that the general public could make phone calls. And even though these devices still weighed up to a kilogram, people were too busy gawping at the fact that they were fully wireless to care. Little did we know that from this point onwards, literally every 10 years, we were about to see one generational leap after another. 2G took the 2.4 kilobits per second speed of 1G and made it over 15 times faster, which made phones not just able to call, but also send text and even picture messages. And we just kept gathering momentum. Literally, 3G was up to 50 times faster than 2G, which actually made it powerful enough to support internet-based applications. The only reason we were able to have apps like Instagram and Uber is because of 3G. I remember when 3G was so cool that Apple actually named one of its smartphones just after its ability to support it. So, it's kind of nuts to think that when 4G came out, it was between 50 and 500 times faster than that. You could do the unthinkable. You could stream Netflix at 1080p. You could play multiplayer games with 100 other players in the same map. It was all about rich multimedia experiences. And that brings us to today, where companies will not stop banging on about what 5G can do. So I'll keep this short. Basically, a good 5G signal means instant sharing. It means browsing the internet with practically non-existent loading times. And it's got such low latency that you could do things like remotely control machines as if they were an extension of you. So what on earth is 6G? Well, the way it works is that pretty much as soon as one generation comes out, a lot of these big tech companies, like Samsung, like Qualcomm, they start working together to figure out what the next one's gonna be. They're kind of investing in their own future, because if they can keep coming up with generations, then they can keep people buying their products based on those generations. So even though we're just seeing 5G roll out now in 2020, Samsung had actually built working 5G back in 2013. So even though 6G is scheduled for 2030, which seems like a mile away, companies are already working on it today. In fact, the very first super early 6G chips have already been built. It's not really 6G, it's not as fast as actual 6G is going to be, but already past the theoretical limit of 5G. And a couple of months ago, Samsung dropped a full document actually showing their plans for 6G, and I think it's fascinating. They put together a diagram here which shows the kinds of ways it might improve on 5G, which is the light blue area in the middle. And this might already look quite impressive on the face of it, but if you look a little closer, you'll realize that it's not a linear scale, meaning that while it looks like the peak data rate is going to triple or maybe quadruple, on this scale, it's 50 times faster than the absolute fastest 5G connection, with a tenth of the latency. They're saying that this will be fast enough to download 100 hours of Netflix in a second. They're saying that it'll be able to support 10 times the number of devices, and that it'll be 100 times as reliable. And you might be sitting there starting to think, why? What's the point? 4G is already fast enough, I barely need 5G, this is ridiculous. But I would argue that it only sounds ridiculous because we aren't living in the society that it's made for. Remember, they're building a technology that's trying to serve the needs of future humanity. 6G has got to be good enough to carry us from 2030 all the way to 2040. And that world is going to look very different to this world. Oh, and if you're enjoying this video, by the way, a sub to the channel would be breathtaking. Let's say you're in a self-driving car, among a whole other network of self-driving cars on a motorway. 5G won't cut it. Think about it, you're on a motorway, you're well away from a city, and yet every single one of these cars has to be online. They have to be able to react to hazards in literally a split second, and the connection can't drop at all, or someone could die. So you need a reliable connection that's powerful enough to process the data from every single one of these cars like that. But to be fair, if we get there, things get juicy. Imagine a world where every car is fully aware of where every other car is. It would mean that when you're planning a route, instead of checking to see where current traffic jams are and trying to avoid them, your car could coordinate with every other car and make sure that nobody ever gets stuck waiting behind someone else. Or like, I talk a fair bit about how I think we're heading towards a mixed reality. Being able to just pop some glasses on or contact lenses that would allow you to see a whole new digital layer to the real world. But think about it, for this to work, you need a network that can support millions, if not billions of users sitting in the same shared augmented reality. Can you imagine the amount of data that would need to be synced instantly between devices? Besides, in the next 20 years, we're going to want data connection in the sea, the sky, and space, and current solutions just don't allow it. So you get the idea. To facilitate the next generation of tech, we need the next generation of network. We need microsecond response times, not the milliseconds we're currently working with. However, there's a problem. So you know how 4G can be a little bit patchy? You don't always get the signal. Well, that's because 4G waves can only travel about 10 miles. So if you're further than 10 miles away from a 4G cell tower, you're probably out of luck. And 5G made this problem worse. See, the only way they've managed to deliver higher speeds is by using smaller, higher frequency waves. They're called millimeter waves because they're literally 1 to 10 millimeters. But because they're so small, they're also more easily blocked. I could have perfect 5G signal, accidentally step behind a tree, and it could just vanish. I'm acting like this is some sort of theoretical scenario. No, I've actually tried this. And so because of this problem, we can't rely on true 5G on its own. For starters, just to get it working in a city, you have to go from one big central tower with 4G to literally a tower on every street for 5G. Plus, there are high-profile leaders right now who are already saying that millimeter wave will never even reach most of the country. And so, these true 5G waves also have to be compensated with something called sub-6 waves. You could think of that as a bit like a 4.5G network. And on top of that, every 5G phone also has to be able to switch seamlessly between 5G, 4G, and 3G, because you will still need them. So, you can probably see where this is going. Even though 6G hasn't been finalized yet, it's looking like that to deliver the speeds we need for it, we might have to use even smaller waves. The current top candidate is sub-millimeter waves, or terahertz waves, which, as you probably guessed, are a tenth of the size of 5G's millimeter waves. If we can't even get these millimeter waves beyond our cities, how are we going to cover the globe in sub-millimeter waves? You see the problem, right? We could start completely covering our skyline in cell towers, maybe. We could force all new buildings to start integrating 6G antennae into the architecture, maybe. We might even need to have 6G transmitters baked into home furniture. Because remember, these waves are so easily blocked, you probably would need multiple transmitters per home. But even if we sort that problem, for 6G to bring the benefits that we want from it, it can't just be faster. It has to be all those other things as well. So, as well as suggesting sub-millimeter wave technology, Samsung also suggested a couple of other candidate technologies to sit alongside it. They suggested, what if we take advantage of all the extra intelligence we've gained in the last 10 years by baking AI into 6G tech directly? It might mean that your devices on 6G could automatically talk to each other and smartly manage data between them. Samsung also mentioned novel antenna technology, which I think is another way of saying we need a more efficient way to build our antennae, but we don't know what it is yet. Another option is maybe instead of having one cell tower that transmits and loads of devices that receive, to make each 6G device capable of being both a receiver and a transmitter. So you could have like a web of devices that are both receiving 6G, but also helping each other to connect to 6G. One thing that does kind of help its case is the fact that when 5G was built, it was built with the capacity to be upgraded. So it's possible that 6G could kind of use the existing towers and framework that has already been built, as opposed to starting from scratch. Anyways, my stance is that I think it's cool. I'm actually excited about this. If I had to guess though, I would say that we probably won't be able to keep up this rate of new generation every 10 years. I would say that given the difficulties we're having with 5G, 6G won't be a viable replacement until 2035. But it's still good to know what we're working towards. Also, so far, each time we've gone from one generation of wireless network to another, there's been a huge jump in power consumption. But I get the feeling that for 6G, because of how aware we're becoming of the damage we're doing to the planet, and because of how much we're trying to slow that down, it might have to somewhat adjust its aspirations based on this. Like, if companies get told, for your 6G infrastructure, you're only allowed to use the same amount of energy as 5G is currently using, then you can imagine they won't be able to make something as powerful, versus if they've just been let loose to go crazy with it. If you enjoyed this video, do consider subscribing, that'd be great. My name is Aaron, this is Mr. Who's the Boss, and I'll catch you in the next one.